Welcome to Arizona Horizon. I'm Ted Simon. 6 years ago, the Arizona Corporation Commission adopted a renewable energy standard that requires public utilities to generate 15% of their energy from renewable resources. Kris Mayes was one of the commissioners who voted for that standard. Today, she works at ASU, where she's the faculty director of the Program on Law and Sustainability for the Sandra Day O'Connor College of Law. I recently spoke with Kris Mayes about Arizona's renewable energy industry. Kris, thanks for joining us tonight on Arizona Horizon.
Thanks, Ted. Great to be with you.
As far as the renewable energy standard is concerned, give us a better definition of what that's all about.
Well, the renewable energy standard, or the RES, is basically a law or a policy that was passed by the Arizona Corporation Commission back in 2006. What it does is it tells the utilities of the state of Arizona that they must produce or procure at least 15% of their total retail sales, their total energy from solar, wind, biomass, biogas, landfill gas, or geothermal. So it basically says to utilities, you got to do more to get more of your energy from renewables.
So 15% by 2025, is that likely to change either a greater standard or a lessening of the standard?
Well, that's the $64,000 question, and I think right now, all else being equal, it probably isn't likely to be changed by the Arizona Corporation Commission. The new commission that was just elected basically has said they're okay with the 15%. By 2025, and they don't want to go much higher. Obviously, there were folks in that campaign who wanted to see, and other folks who would like to see the standard be increased. The fact of the matter is that while our standard has a very high requirement within it for solar rooftops, and we are, because of that, going to be doing more solar rooftops on a per capita basis than any other state in the country, the overall standard at 15% is still much smaller than our surrounding states. So there's a lot of people who would like to see us take that and go a little bit further. And then I would add to that, it's interesting, the utilities have recently said that they are doing so well toward meeting that standard, they're going to meet it in 2 years, so which is 10 years early, they'll be done.
So why wouldn't you consider then heightening the standard a little bit? If it's that easy to get to now, you're 10 years ahead of schedule, why not bump the schedule a little bit?
Well, personally, I'm in favor of that. I mean, it's something that I think we do need to look at. I think that there's a lot of Arizonans who believe that it's time that we look at that. And I think there's a lot of Arizonans who would say, gosh, you know, if the utilities are going to be done in 2 years, we don't want them to stop. We want them to continue to do renewable energy. I mean, there's nothing, frankly, in Arizona that's more popular than solar energy. So I think that's going to be a subject of conversation over the next couple of years. You may even see potentially something like a ballot initiative that would say, all right, you know, we really do believe that in some way Arizona should continue to do solar energy.
The impact, you mentioned the Republican team, three Republicans that ran as a team, won as a team. Keeping the standard as is not likely to be all that aggressive as far as moving the standard forward. What other impact do you see from the new commissioners?
Well, you know, that's interesting. I think the new commissioners basically indicated they're okay with where the standard is, and I think they also said we're going to faithfully execute and implement the existing standard. So I think you will see that. I think there are a couple of them that are very interested in water issues, so you may see more of a focus on, you know, fixing our private water companies, which many of which are broken right now. I think you're going to see a focus on some more traditional rate-making issues, maybe some of the more sort of meat and potatoes type stuff that the Corporation Commission does, which is basically set rates for and prices for utilities. So, you know, I think that you'll continue to see a focus on renewables because those issues are always going to come up. You're going to continue to see a focus on water, and I think also maybe on energy efficiency. You know, Arizona has one of the highest energy efficiency standards in the country at 22%.
What about the congressional delegation in terms of things happening back in Washington as opposed to starting to happen out here? I mean, talk about that dynamic, and I mean, we could very possibly see a Democratic majority as far as the congressional delegation is concerned. Impact there?
Yeah, no, I think it's a great point, and I think you have you know, the potential for having a majority Democratic delegation, two of which, at least two of which, maybe even more, are strong supporters of solar in the form of in renewable energy, in the form of Ron Barber and Kyrsten Sinema, also probably Ann Kirkpatrick. But I will add Matt Salmon, who was just reelected as a Republican in the East Valley, is one of the strongest proponents of solar energy that Arizona's ever had. In fact, Congressman Salmon, when he was congressman in the 1990s, was actually one of the co-founders of the Solar Caucus in Congress, and was one of the co-sponsors of the investment tax credit, which has yielded so much solar energy and renewables across the country.
Well, with that in mind, talk about some of the policy concerns regarding renewables that this congressional delegation will face right now.
Well, right now, this delegation is going to face a really critical issue, which is whether or not to extend what's called the production tax credit. The PTC is a tax credit that's kind of obscure. Nobody knows about it, but it's incredibly important to supporting renewables, especially wind. And so this wind incentive has to be extended this year, or it goes away and this country will lose literally tens of thousands of jobs in the wind sector, and probably Arizona will lose the opportunity to do additional wind projects, you know, particularly in northern Arizona. So that's the first issue. And I think the congressional delegation in general is going to be asked to, you know, sort of carry the torch on solar. We'll see whether we can get the Solar Caucus kick-started. We'll see whether somebody steps up the way Gabby Giffords did during her time in Congress and really supports solar energy and becomes a strong, vocal champion of solar in Arizona.
That first credit you were talking about, is that the lame duck issue? The Congress, lame duck Congress, going to have to take that up?
I think they should. If they don't, we're in a world of hurt. I mean, the PTC is probably in a world of hurt. It's possible they could pass the PTC, the production tax credit, in the early part of next year, maybe as part of a fiscal cliff type resolution. I don't know, but it's got to get going. They got to do something about it, or we're going to lose a lot of jobs.
How much did the Solyndra controversy hurt the industry in general?
I don't think you can understate. I don't think you can overstate how bad that was. You know, it's unfortunate that it happened. Failures always happen in a nascent and young industry. But the fact of the matter is that a lot of Americans see that as something of an emblem now. And obviously people on the far right took it up and tried to sort of tarnish and tag all of renewable energy with Solyndra. So I think it was awful. I don't think we can, you know, sweep it under the rug or ignore it. You just have to face it and go on and talk about all the successes that we've had in this area.
Well, let's talk about something that you're working on at ASU that is hopefully will be a success, the Utility of the Future Center. What is that all about?
Well, the Utility of the Future Center is something that we're just launching at ASU, and the idea behind it is that we know that because of these policies that you and I have just been talking about that we've passed in Arizona and elsewhere nationally, people are doing more solar on their rooftops. You know, thousands of people in Arizona, tens of thousands of people are solarizing their homes. And what that means is essentially you are becoming increasingly independent of the utilities. No longer do you derive as much of your energy from the utilities. And over time, it means the utilities are going to have less and less business. When we reach the point where you can put solar on your rooftop for the same price that you can buy energy from APS, it means a lot of people are going to leave these utilities. And that isn't necessarily, it's good in the long term in the sense that people will be able to produce their own power. It could be bad in the short term in the sense that we can't have utilities that are completely unhealthy. So we can't have this total disruption. We need to find a way for the utilities to bridge into a more decentralized future and become a part of the solar revolution.
So basically the center will look at business models, maybe developing new rate designs, these sorts of things to help with a changing...
Exactly, with a changing energy landscape. And the idea is these utilities are going to need to have new business models developed We're going to have to develop new rate designs to assist both consumers and utilities in bridging into the future. We're going to have education of regulators about what's going to need to happen to bridge into this near this future. We're also going to have to help consumers deal with both, but with all of these huge changes that could happen in our energy sector.
And I noticed it was a three-pronged approach. It's utilities, it is regulators, and it is consumers. Helping with the regulators, I mean, do the regulators necessarily want that help?
Well, we'll see. We'll offer it and we'll see if they take it up, right? But I think they do, and the problem with this is that both regulation and the utilities tend to be pretty staid. I mean, it's a pretty traditional, resistant to change industry and you know, sort of regulatory environment. And so it's going to take some time for people to get used to these new rate designs, these new business models. It's going to take some time for consumers to get used to them, and it's going to take a lot of education on all those fronts.
I was going to say, the scenario you outlined, I mean, as far as consumers are concerned, you're going to have to be able to monitor, you're going to have to be able to control your energy needs, your energy output, the whole nine yards.
Right.
A lot of folks, you know, they can barely handle paying the bill every month. I mean, that's, there's a lot of education to be done there.
There is, there's so many changes, and it's happening so rapidly, and we think it could happen so rapidly, that getting people up to speed, making sure people are comfortable with this is important. And not everybody is going to make this transition at the same pace. That's what's so interesting about this new area and the utility of the future and the consumer of the future. You know, you may decide to solarize your house. I may decide to solarize my townhouse. But you know, your neighbor doesn't necessarily want to do that. Your grandmother may not do that. And yet your grandmother still needs to have power delivered to her house. And so we have to make sure that everybody, no matter where they are on the spectrum of their energy usage, and their desire to go solar or to go more energy efficient, is provided for.
And that brings me to the last question here, talking about how it's almost as if the goalposts are moving, not only for consumers, not only for regulators, but for utilities, the entire industry. Is that good, or is that just making it that much more difficult? It seems like every year there's new technology. Prices go up, the prices go down, the Chinese dump on the market, the Chinese pull back. I mean, that's got to be difficult to get a handle on.
I think it is, but in the long run, I think it is good, because we're all striving for one objective, and we're starting to see it on the horizon. And that objective, in my mind, is that each of us has an equal opportunity to provide energy to ourselves and to become more independent, not only of other countries, but of our utilities, of monopolies, and so we're reaching that point. It's in sight, but the next couple of years and beyond that, maybe even the next 10 years, are going to be critical. And as you said, you're going to see all kinds of new technologies that are developed over time, and that are tried. Some will fail. Not everything is going to succeed. But certainly getting to that point is where we want to be.
All right. Kris, good to see you. Thanks for joining us. We appreciate it.
Great to be here.